A new season and a new era of Bobcat football is upon us, the GJ Kinne era. One of the rising coaching stars, the country takes over a Texas State program that embarks on its 12th year in the FBS in 2023. And with that, we welcome you to the End Zone Complex here at Bobcat Stadium for the special 2023 season preview. Brant Freeman alongside Keith Moreland. Keith and I, of course, are in the TV booth again this year for coverage of Bobcat home games, and this will be our fourth year together, Keith. What have you enjoyed during your time covering this program?
Well, the growth of the program, there's no question. The growth of the university, obviously, and the student body, and then here at the stadium, and things that the changes that are going to come. You've seen some changes. It is so much fun to come back and be involved. And when I say come back, I was here on a coaching staff for baseball in the early 90s, so it was really interesting to see what's taking place, and now we've got some new excitement with the change.
Yeah, that's Keith's connection here to Texas State. A lot of people associate you with the University of Texas, a Hall of Fame baseball player for the Longhorns, later played in the majors. The Cubs won a series with the Phillies. And again, your connections here to Texas State, what do you recall about your time as a coach with this university?
Well, First of all, not having anywhere for our kids to go change the clothes, no real locker room and everything, but to see the transformation of the university and how they treat athletics and what we're seeing. And now with the addition and the change as a head coach, I'm really excited to see what's going on. It's not really a culture change. It's an excitement change.
Yep. I mentioned, you know, your time as a baseball player, and part of your broadcasting career has taken you to coverage of the Little League World Series. You just got back from covering that, one of the regionals in Waco. How much would you enjoy that in the summer?
I think that's probably the most fun that I get to do all year long. I mean, there was a young woman that was outstanding in the tournament to see a team that has to come through the loser's bracket, punch a ticket to Williamsport, and it starts on the 16th, and I can't wait to go see it.
Right. Well, I tell you what, enough of the pleasantries here. Keith, let's get to football now. Talking Texas State football, you kind of wrap up this past year, four-win season, led to a change in leadership, the hiring of GJ Kinne as the head coach a year ago, was out in Carter Ward, a great season with the Cardinals in 2022. When the hire was made, what was your initial reaction to GJ Kinne?
Well, I think it's a great hire. I mean, he's a guy that's made a decision that he wanted to be a head coach. He wanted to be a head coach in this state. He feels comfortable with that. And the other thing is, for Bobcat fans, and I'm a fan, I want to see some offense, and you've gotten one of the best offensive minds around bringing in. So I anticipate the one thing we will see is some things going down the field and a lot of points scored.
Yes, we will. I tell you what, though, let's now take a look at the offseason timeline for this program, starting with the hiring of GJ Kinne. You look down this list, Keith, and one of the things that jumps out to me was the addition of David Bailiff on the staff.
No question. I've known David Bailiff for almost 40 years, and I don't believe that tells you a whole lot about the head coach, because I'm not sure David would take this job unless he had a lot of feelings for the head coach, and I think that's important. You've got to have people around you that are committed to you as a head coach.
Yep. Something else on this offseason timeline, the groundbreaking of the new performance center that's going to the renovations will take place actually in the building we're in right now, the South End Zone Complex, a $37 million renovation project scheduled to be completed by next fall of 2024. You can get more information by going to txstfootballcenter.com. I want to get back to Coach Kinne here for a moment, and you talked about UIW, and what really got people excited was the play of his offense. More than 50 points a game a year ago, among the nation leaders in yards per game as well, very efficient on third downs. This was a program for him a year ago that could score, that really makes your mouth water a bit thinking about what could be here.
Yeah, I think there's no question. When you look at being able to put points on the board, we play college football now in a society that's created about excitement, and offense is excitement. You look at the Bobcats last year, they had a difficult time getting separation from wide receivers, finding a way to get more than 16 points in a game in seven of the ball games. So you've got to find a way to put points on the board, and coach has been involved in how many offenses from many different people. It's just the people he's been around. Chip Kelly, Gus Malzahn. Mm-hmm. Those are the people that are his mentors that he's been underneath. All those guys are offensive guys, and they put points on the board.
Well, I'll tell you what. Up next, we're going to talk more about Coach Kinne, his journey from Texas high school quarterback in Gilmer to now here at Texas State as the head coach of this Bobcat program. Stay tuned. We got more of the season preview coming up after this.
People are always searching for what's next. At Texas State University, we are driving what's next. And next is now.
Next home game by getting your tickets online at txstatebobcats.com today.
At Texas State University, we are builders and creators, pushing the boundaries of what human ingenuity can do. You're an analytical thinker and you like to know how things work. Then you try to make them better. You will find countless opportunities to feed your curiosity and imagination here. You can immerse yourself in green research to protect the planet or help develop new technology for a mission to Mars. This is your chance to be at the cutting edge of what's new and what's next.
Like where we're at, felt like we added the depth that we needed. I just think there's still a lot of question marks on who's going to be the starters, and that going into that Baylor week. It's probably going to be a game time decision on a lot of those guys. Hopefully, what we talked about yesterday as a staff, hopefully, some guys step up or, it makes it easy on us. But a lot of times in my experience, it's, out there on game day, who plays the best.
That was head coach GJ Kinne addressing the media during one of the press conferences early on in fall training camp. We talked about Coach Kinne before, Keith. Now I kind of want to get into how he wound up here. And again, his journey started at Gilmer High School, a great program, which, by the way, his head coach, Coach Jeff Traylor, yep, is now, of course, the head coach at UTSA.
We'll talk. Start a hookup in a game this year, won't they?
Yes, we'll talk more about that game coming up in just a bit. Goes on to become a coach, or a quarterback, rather, at University of Tulsa. After that, some time with the pros.
Yeah, he throws from over 9,000 yards in college. He's a guy that's been around offense. And I think one of the things that you look at is when you're an offensive coach, and even though he's a head coach, when you're an offensive coach, I think the first thing you do is you start looking at personnel. What do we have to do personnel-wise? I think that he has seen that in two or three different styles. You got Gus Malzahn, as I talked about, he creates different things, but the running game is very important to him. On the other side, when you look at Chip Kelly, it's about matchups. He tries to get your defense in a matchup situation. So I think Coach Kinne has seen all of that, and I think he's accommodated that together. And then last year, in a cornered word, you just see 50 points a game.
Somebody else who was mentored him, Doug Peterson, who, yep, of course, won a Super Bowl with the Eagles in 2017. And you look at Coach Peterson and the ties, with Coach Kinne. He, of course, was with the Philadelphia Eagles for a couple of years. One of the connections he made was with Lane Johnson, one of the great offensive tackles in the NFL today. The two still have a very tight friendship. Lane Johnson spoke to the team during the offseason as well. Those NFL connections really have helped Coach Kinne a lot in his coaching journey.
Well, I think all young men in the state of Texas feel like they want to go to college and then a chance to go become a professional athlete, especially if you're a football player, that's the NFL. So I think just to have the ability to reach back at some of your history, mm-hmm, and to be able to help young men, especially when you go in and start recruiting, we haven't got to that because of the changes in the personnel here, you're going to have to spend, it's a year-round process, yeah, recruiting, and to have that knowledge and those people in your pocket, sure enough, to have.
Do you want to get to the recruiting, the personnel?
Yeah, I think personnel is so important.
Well, we're going to do that coming up next. Again, a lot of roster turnover, a lot of new blood. Some players from last year gone. We have a lot to discuss there, and we'll do that when we come back right after this.
People are always searching for what's next. At Texas State University, we are driving what's next. And next is now.
You see it there, 72 newcomers on this year's team having to help replace 18 starters gone from last year. Also note, 19 Power 5 transfers and a lot of familiar faces with Coach Kinne. Nine of his players from UIW a year ago, now here at Texas State. Welcome back inside the South End Zone Complex. Our season preview continues, talking about the roster turnover. We talked a little bit, Keith, about last season, a 4-8 year. There were a lot of needs that had to be addressed. What did you perceive the biggest ones to be?
Well, I think the first and foremost, obviously it all starts with the signal caller, and we've seen three different ones that have moved in and being involved in this. We're not going to try to give names out of who's ahead in this part and that part, because it's a battle right now. Yeah. Somebody's going to pull out of that, and it's going to be the guy that's going to be taking the snaps. And then the other part for me is I do every year, you talk about it, I think offensive line is the cornerstone of any football team. You got to find a way to have five guys up front that can work coherently together in an offense that is going to be rapid fire.
Yeah.
So things are going to come at you in a hurry. You have to be able to pick up. There's a lot of base blocking. People don't realize in this style of offense, it's a very base blocking, but you've got to give your QB time to get rid of the football. And then the last thing, it's one of the things that I saw all year last year, wide receivers struggling to get separation.
Mm-hmm.
Just the ability. Ashton Hawkins can get separation,
yeah,
but we didn't have him for a few ball games throughout the year, so taking care of him. But I just think those are the keys for me. Who's going to be the signal caller? How does he handle this hurry-up style?
Mm-hmm.
And then what the offensive line does, and then can receivers get separation?
It's funny you mentioned Hawkins. He actually got hurt on a punt return in Monroe late last season, was out for the remainder of the year after that game against ULM, and entered the transfer portal in the offseason. One of the biggest recruiting jobs that Coach Kinne did was to bring him back into the fold. Going to be a big part of the offense this year. So you addressed the biggest needs offensively, the line, quarterbacks, receiver. Now defensively, there's some retention there, yes, but a change in scheme for the three-down lineman look to the 4-2-5.
Yeah, I'm a huge 4-2-5 guy. I like that. I just think with the styles of offense you see now in college football, where everybody's in a hurry up at times, everybody's going to try to create motion. They're trying to create matchups. It's a lot of matchup football. I think it gives you a better opportunity with the four-down lineman to control the running game with the four-down lineman, and it allows your secondary, seven guys being able to move together. And the other part of that is you can get three corners on the field in a 4-2-5. And I think in today's offenses, you're having three full corners. That's their job. They're a corner. Even though one of them may be playing in the slot in a nickel corner, it's still a corner position.
Well, let's find out where these guys came from. Again, 72 newcomers on this year's team, 52 of those on scholarship. You have nearly 30 FBS transfers, 13 for the FCS, the bulk of those, of course, from UIW, 9 JUCO transfers, and Texas high school players, 19 as a part of the class.
Yeah, I think that last one's a big one for me. I think when you looked at it, when you're trying to change a team and what's going on, you go into the portal, you try to get transfers, but I think in the state of Texas, there are 400 young men a year play college football from the state of Texas. They're tremendous players. A lot of them go on to the NFL. You've got to be able to go out and recruit high school kids where you have them on campus for an extended period of time. So I think that number is probably the one that I'm most impressed with.
We've talked a lot of Texas State. You ready to talk about other teams?
Well, let's do it.
I'll tell you what, we'll do that. Coming up, we'll talk about the non-conference schedule, the first four games of the year. All starts with a game in Waco, followed by a game against those rivals, south and I-35 in San Antonio. More on that coming up as our season preview continues after this.
Every hero need his theme music. Sit on the throne and you can never move it. I hear my destiny is calling. So say hello to the champ, yeah. Yeah, I say hello to the champ. Yeah, I say hello to the champ, yeah. I say hello to the champ. Hey, I say hello to the champ.
champion. Ooh,
say hello,
say hello.
All these wins starting to feel spiritual. Baby, that is magic. Welcome to the late show. I be King James version when I'm on the West Coast. Hey, ride around in the rage. Wind blowing my cape. Waving all the two peasants. Don't you ruin my day. Step into the ring, I'm Ali in the steam. Rumble in the jungle every time I'm on the beat. I don't care what you say.
What you say?
You run the bag when I play.
Run the bag, run the bag.
Get it out the mud every day.
Out the mud, yeah.
Guess that's why they call me Cassius Clay.
Oh yeah.
Every hero need his theme music. Sit on the throne and you can never move it. I hear my destiny is calling. So say hello to the champ, yeah.
People are always searching for what's next. At Texas State University, we are driving what's next. And next is now.
To win a championship, the great teams I've been a part of, those leaders really stepped up in the summer and ran the show.
Take care of your teammates tonight, right? Take care of your teammates tonight. Habits reflect the mission in everything you do, right? Everything you do. Get some recovery tomorrow. Eat, sleep, hydrate. You got me?
I'm excited to see those leaders kind of emerge and see how this thing unfolds.
This season marks year number 12 for the Bobcats and the FBS, number 11 in the Sun Belt Conference. There are 8 conference games, so 4 non-conference games, the first 4 of the season. We'll take a look at those now. And Keith, worth noting, the very first 2 games on the road, trips north on 35 and south.
Yeah, when you take on the Baylor Bears, which are predicted to be in the upper echelon of the Big 12, in their ballpark, the first thing you're going to take care of it is you got to protect the football. Mm-hmm. It is a big hill to climb, but you want to go out, you want to get into your flow of your offense and show that you can compete at a level nationally.
UTSA, though, that's the big game. Oh. Everybody's got circled on their calendar. You and I tease a little bit the Jeff Traylor, GJ Kinne connection. Anytime those two play, great environments, you know, in the stadium. Last time these two played was in that pandemic year of 2020, a game that went double overtime. That's a big one in the Dome.
It is a big one in the Dome. There's no question. And regardless of what anybody says, it is a rivalry. It's one of those things that the kids, even though there's a lot of new kids here, mm-hmm. they know what's going on between UTSA and Texas State. And then the last part of that is the whole city of Gilmer may be there.
They might be. The non-conference schedule wraps up with the FCS opponent, Jackson State. No Dion this year. Now he's in Colorado. And then Nevada rematch of last year's opener in Reno. Keith, this has been great talking Bobcat football with you, looking to doing more of that at Bobcat Stadium this year.
Oh, I had a blast. Can't wait to get it started.
Again, year 4 for Keith coming up, year 1 for GJ Kinne, and we have more of the season preview series coming up as well as we break down more of the offense and the defense here from the End Zone Complex. For Keith Moreland, I'm Brant Freeman. Stay tuned for more of the season preview, and we'll see you next time.